The Life and Adventures of Peter Wilkins by Robert Paltuk. Chapter 4. I seemed to be very well satisfied whilst my master was speaking, but though I thought he talked like an angel, my former uneasiness seized me at parting with him. In short, without more consideration, I rose in the morning early and marched off, having first wrote to my wife at her aunt's, relating the state of the case to her, with my resolution to leave England the first opportunity, giving her what comfort I could, assuring her if I ever was a gainer in life, she should not fail to be a partaker, and promising also to let her know where I settled. I walked at a great rate for fear my master's kindness should prompt him to send after me, and taking the byways I reached by dark night a little village, where I resolved to halt. Upon inquiry, I found myself 35 miles from my master's. I had eaten nothing all day, and was very hungry and weary. But my crown piece was as yet whole. However, I fed very sparingly, being overpressed with the distress of my affairs, and the confusion of my thoughts. I slept that night tolerably, but the morning brought its face of horror with it. I had inquired overnight where I was, and been informed that I was not above 16 miles from Bristol, for which place I then resolved. At my setting out in the morning, after I had walked about 3 miles, and had recollected a little my master's last discourse, I found by degrees my spirit grew calmer than it had been since I left Mr. G. at my house, as I shall ever call it, and, looking into myself for the cause, found another set of thoughts were preparing a passage into my mind, which did not carry half the dread and terror with them that their predecessors had. For I began to cast aside the difficulties and apprehensions I before felt in my way, and, encouraging the present motions, soon became sensible of the benefit of a virtuous education. And though what I had hitherto done in the immediate service of God I must own had been performed from force, custom, and habit, and without the least attention to the object of the duty, yet, as under my mother at home and my master at the academy, I had been always used to say my prayers, as they called it, morning and night. I began with a sort of superstitious reflection to accuse myself of having omitted that duty the night before, and also at my setting out in the morning, and very much to blame myself for it, and, at the same instant, even wondered at myself for that blame. "What," says I, "is the real use of this praying? And to whom or to what do we pray? I see no one to pray to. Neither have I ever thought that my prayers would be answered. It is true they are worded as if we prayed to God, but He is in heaven. Does He concern Himself with us who can do Him no service? Can I think all my prayers that I have said from day to day so many years have been heard by Him? No, sure. If they had, I should scarce have sustained this hard fate in my fortune. But hold, how have I prayed to Him? Have I earnestly prayed to Him as I used to petition my mother for anything when I wanted it against her inclination? No, I can't say I have. And would my mother have granted me such things if she had not thought I had from my heart desired them when I used to be so earnest with her? No, surely. I can't say she had any reason for it. But I had her indeed before me. Now I have not God in my view. He is in heaven. Yet let me see. My master, and I can't help thinking he must know, used to say that God is a spirit, and not confined by the encumbrance of a body as we are. Now, if it is so, why may He not virtually be present with me, though I don't perceive Him? Why may He not be at once in heaven and elsewhere? For if He insists not in parts, nothing can circumscribe Him. And truly I believe it must be so. For if He is of that supreme power as He is represented, He could never act in so unconfined a capacity, under the restraint of place. But if He is an operative and purely spiritual being, then I can see no reason why His virtual essence should not be diffused through all nature. And then, which I began to think most likely, Why should I not suppose him ever present with me, and able to hear me? And why should not I, when I pray, have a full idea of the being, though not of any corporeal parts or form of God, and so have actually somewhat to be intent upon in my prayers, and not do as I have hitherto done, say so many words only upon my knees, which I cannot help thinking may be as well without either sense or meaning in themselves, as without a proper object in my mind to direct them unto. These thoughts agitated me at least 2 miles, working stronger and stronger in me, till at length, bursting into tears, "Have I been doing nothing," says I, "in the sight of God, under the name of prayers, for so many years?" "Yes, it is certainly so." "Well, by the grace of God, it shall be so no longer. I will try somewhat more." So, looking round about me, to see if I was quite alone, I stepped into an adjoining copse, and could scarce refrain falling on my knees, till I came to a proper place for kneeling in. I then poured forth my whole soul and spirit to God, and all my strength, every member, every faculty, was to the utmost employed, for a considerable time, in the most agreeable as well as useful duty. I would indeed have begun with my accustomed prayers, and had repeated some words of them, when, as though against and contrary to my design, I was carried away by such rapturous effusions that, to this hour, when I reflect thereon, I cannot believe but I was moved to them by a much more than human impulse. However, this ecstasy did not last above a quarter of an hour, but it was considerably longer before my spirits subsided to their usual frame. When I had a little composed myself, how was I altered? How did I condemn myself for all my past disquiet? What calm thanks did I return for the ease and satisfaction of mind I then enjoyed? And coming to a small rivulet, I drank a hearty draught of water and contentedly proceeded on my journey. I reached Bristol about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Having refreshed myself, I went the same evening to the quay to inquire what ships were in the river, whither bound, and when they would depart. My business was with the sailors, of whom there were at that time great numbers there. But I could meet with no employ, though I gave out, I would gladly enter myself before the mast. After I had done the best I could, but without success, I returned to the little house I had dined at, and went to bed very pensive. I did not forget my prayers, but I could by no means be roused to such devotion as I felt in the morning. Next day, I walked again to the quay, asking all I met, who looked like seafaring men, for employment, but could hear of none, there being many waiting for berths. And I feared my appearance, which was not so mean as most of that sort of gentry is, would prove no small disappointment to my preferment that way. At last, being out of heart with my frequent repulses, I went to a landing-place just by, and as I asked some sailors who were putting 2 gentlemen on shore if they wanted a hand on board their ship, one of the gentlemen, whom I afterwards found to be the master of a vessel bound to the coast of Africa, turned back, and looking earnestly on me, "Young man," says he, "do you want employment on board?" I immediately made him a bow, and answered, "Yes, sir." Said he, "There is no talking in this weather," for it now blew almost a storm, "but step into that tavern," pointing to the place, "and I'll be with you presently." I went thither, and not long after came my future master. He asked me many questions, but the first was whether I had been at sea. I told him no, but I did not doubt soon to learn the duty of a sailor. He then looked on my hand, and shaking his head, told me it would not do, for I had too soft a hand. I told him I was determined for the sea, and that my hand and heart should go together, and I hoped my hand would soon harden, though not my heart. He then told me it was a pity to take such a pretty young fellow before the mast, but if I understood accounts tolerably, and could write with a good hand, he would make me his steward, and make it worth my while. I answered in the affirmative, joyfully accepting his offer, but on his asking me where my chest was, for, says he, if the wind had not been so strong against me, I had fallen down the river this morning, I looked very blank, and plainly told him I had no other stores than I carried on my back. The captain smiled. Says he, young man, I see you are a novice. Why, the meanest sailor in my ship has a chest, at least, and perhaps something in it. Come, says he, my lad, I like your looks. Be diligent and honest. I will let you have a little money to set you out, and deduct it in your pay. He was then pulling out his purse, when I begged him, as he seemed to show me so great a kindness, that he would order somebody to buy what necessaries he knew I should want for me, or I should be under as great a difficulty to know what to get, and where to buy them, as I should have been at for want of them. He commended my prudence, and said he would buy them, and send them on board himself. So bid me trouble myself no more about them, but go to the ship in return of his boat, and stay there till he came, giving me a ticket to the boat's crew to take me in. When I came to the shore, the boat was gone off and at a good distance. But I hailed them, and, showing my ticket, they put back and took me safe to the ship, heartily glad that I was entered upon my new service. End of chapter 4.